Good afternoon, everybody. Thanks for coming to this Dean's Lecture. And as you all know, these are to celebrate the appointment or promotion of people who are appointed, promoted to professor. And today we're here to celebrate Arturo Casadevall. And, you know, I was talking to people today in the hallway about this, and they were asking me questions like, is he going to show pictures of dinosaurs? And I said, and those of you who were here when he interviewed for the chair job remember that talk very well. It's still famous, you know, fungus and dinosaurs. But Arturo is the Alfred and Jill Sommer Professor and Chair of the W. Harry Feinstone Department of Molecular Microbiology and Immunology, and also a Bloomberg Distinguished Professor. And he came to our school in January of 2015 from Einstein in New York, where he had spent most of his career, had risen through the ranks, first in the Department of Medicine and became chair, division chief of infectious disease, and then moved to basic sciences where he was chair of the Department of Microbiology. And at Einstein had two separate endowed chairs at two different parts of his career. When he interviewed here for deanship, we knew he was special and outstanding, and he was the only candidate that I've ever seen who listed McDonald's on his CV as his first position, and talked about it during his job talk. So he's been here, you know, for a while. He's, as you know, an expert in fungus, has worked a lot on Cryptococcus, but has also worked on anthrax and HIV and a number of other pathogens. He's been an active editor throughout his career, and it was that experience I think you're going to talk about today. But he talked about that here as you know, the issues of reproducibility and how scientists think, and because of that, he one of the reasons that we were able to get him here was this program now called the 3 R's, which you'll talk about, I'm sure. But the idea of putting philosophy back into the PhD and teaching us how to think better and to understand causal inference. And I think I won't say anything more about that because I think Arturo will talk about that. But everybody probably knows his background, that he emigrated to the U.S. from Cuba when he was 11 years old and fled Castro's Cuba and earned his MS, PhD, and MD degrees at New York University. He's a member of the Institute of Medicine and has had numerous honors and awards. And I won't go through those because I don't want to take away from your talk. But please join me in welcoming Arturo Casadevall.
So thank you, Mike, for the very nice introduction. Thank you for coming. Obviously, we're going to talk about problems in biomedical science, but I think all of you know me, but I will tell you that I'm a working scientist. This is what I do for a living. I was writing a grant last night. I will be writing a grant tonight. I live and die by grants, and I do this. And this is lab celebrating Halloween. They decided to get dressed like me. I threw away our jackets so you look all right, you know, when you sit down at meetings and wear a jean so you're comfortable at the bottom. I haven't been wearing a jean today. So how did I get into this? I got into this by professional, from being an editor of Infection and Immunity. I noticed a lot of problems with peer review, and I noticed I began to collaborate with the editor-in-chief, and our first collaboration was I was tired of people putting down science as descriptive. It was very clear they didn't know what they were talking about. They would contrast descriptive to mechanistic when in reality those are not contradistinctions. So that was the first paper we wrote. And in fact, we follow it up later, and this is a problem. A scientist walks into a dark room, sees a light, the description, the mechanism is a candle, and you can see that mechanism and description is nothing more but in depth. But in reality, some scientists wanted causality, others wanted depth. But I began to realize that there were major problems, even at the editors, at the review level. So the second reason is the public health relevance of this. These are from the CDC, the 10 major accomplishments of public health in the 20th century. And the majority of them, there is a basic science associated with it. If there are problems in basic science, there are going to be problems in public health. And the third one is personal. That's my mother. I should have changed this slide. She's 93, just turned 93 last week. And she was well till age 88, but now has a lot of problems. And those are the same medicines that I used in Bellevue Hospital in 1985. And I cannot believe that this is as good as we're going to do. A lot of these medicines are older than I am. Actually, most of them are. At least 3 out of 5. I can't believe that in fact, that we cannot do better. So our approach is we work within science. We don't go around giving news conferences. We get data, we analyze it, we publish it in peer-reviewed journals. We work with society and other scientists, and our goal is to improve science. And my bigger goal here is to try to define a corpus of knowledge that will one day become the science of science. That is, the ability to study science to increase its efficiency. So the geography of this presentation, we're going to begin optimistic. We're going to get really depressed. And I promise you at the end that we'll end up in a positive tone. And I promise you that I will convince you that there are solutions to all these problems. So if you think of the big problems of humanity, these are at least 6 of them. Climate change, you don't need a jacket in Baltimore in the middle of February. The faltering green revolution. 80% of our calories are coming from 6 or 7 plants that are monophyletic. If 2 of those collapse at any one time, we would have major problems with starvation. Pandemics, we have 1 a year. Ebola, Zika, SARS, you name it. A rock from outer space, new energy sources, and hate, which at the end of the day is something in the realm of neuroscience. And I would argue that the solutions lie in scientific and technological advances, both in the natural and social sciences. These are the big problems that humanity is facing, and this is what's going to basically stress our species in the next few centuries. The world population is 7 billion plus, and notice that it is flat for most of history and takes off logarithmically around 1750. What happened around 1750? It was the scientific revolution. The scientific revolution has given humanity the capacity to avoid a Malthusian crisis every generation. Every generation, you produce more food and more resources, and the net result is that we have been successful beyond our wildest dreams. To give you an example, this was the richest person of the 19th century. Her husband died of salmonella. She lost children to diphtheria and hemophilia during her reign. 1 million people starved in Ireland, and even though that was terribly mishandled, this was the first time in history when food was sent from one country to another. The reason for that is humanity never has had food to send to anyone. Today, we have the capacity for excess food. That's come from advances in science and technology. She passed the hemophilia trait to the houses of Europe. I know you have to read the Romanov to see the consequences of that for the Russian house. She traveled only to 3 countries. She grew up in a palace that was full of smoke, and at least in the first years as a queen, she used chamber pots. None of you want her life. Why don't you want her life? Because in the 5 or 6 generations since then, the quality of life has improved that the best life of the 19th century is not a life that anybody aspires to. For me, my grandfather was born during her reign. 1888, so I'm connected at least from 3 generations. That this is not that far ago, away, and yet we have made tremendous progress. So science growth is dependent on innovation, science, and technology. To put this in perspective, in the 700 years between the end of the Roman Empire and the High Middle Ages, the time of Dante, the time of the Renaissance, the early Renaissance, the economy of Europe grew by 1%. 1%. Today, we want growth of several percent per year. And in this world, you're born and you die in the same world. You see no technological advances, something that is totally foreign to the way that we have grown. In terms of these are antidotes to pessimism. So everyone is pessimistic with the news nowadays, and I don't blame anyone, but look at these numbers. This is the progress of humanity, extreme poverty, democracy, basic education, vaccination, literacy, and child mortality. And I think our goal as a species is to keep these trends to going forward and to make sure that we don't falter. You can see that there are breaks sometimes, but generally the trend is in the right direction. But there are problems in this research enterprise. And the problems are with within science and outside of science. So external funding is always a problem. You have a societal focus on short-term rewards, educational debits, a reduced focus on basic science. The significant statement on grants is probably a tremendous retrograde step. If you can think about something to be useful, it may not be the most important work that one would be doing. There are workforce imbalances. What do I mean by that? The age, for example, at which people get the NIH keeps getting grant, first grant keeps getting older. We live in an anti-intellectual era, and science is under attack. However, there are problems within the enterprise. We have disproportionate rewards to winners. We have an obsession of surrogate markets of importance, the impact factor, the age factor. This is a battle that has to be fought every day. People want to reduce the value of a scientist to a number and then basically make decisions on that, and that is terrible in many levels, as I will. Overspecialization, the economic system of science may not be the best, and poor communication with the public, and most recently, problems in reproducibility. So the solutions here are at the level of society and politics, but these are totally within the realm of what scientists can do. So funding is a chronic problem, as we all know, and this is the trend in the United States, declining funds. But problem number two is also, how do we allocate it? We allocate it by a study section. Good. At least we have peer review there. But we ask scientists to rank grants. And there was a paper published in Science in 2015 that suggested that there was a signature, that is, that scientists could, if you took at all the percentile scores, that you could look at, that they would be able to stratify grants. Well, we got the same data, and we focused only on the 20 percentile. And you can see that there, in fact, whether a grant that was funded got a 19 percentile or a 2 or 3 percentile, there is no difference. There may be a little bit of a trend for the ones that go on 1 to 2 percentage, but those grants are not cut. Usually, grants, to the budget is not cut, so there may be even internal problems here in believing that, that there could be some discriminatory power at the very low percentages. If you look at, if you ask the question, when study sections meet and they talked and they talked and they rank, how much do they contribute to the outcome relative to taking the grants and just doing a lottery? It's about 1.7%. That will be the area under the curve. So peer review, and this was published, is a crapshoot. We wrote an editorial that got people pretty upset, especially when it appeared in the Wall Street Journal, and then the NIH got called by the White House. Well, so we have proposed an alternate scheme that, in fact, you maintain peer review, but you break it into two categories, meritorious and non-meritorious, and this be handled by a lottery. Lotteries are used for difficult decisions. In ancient time, for example, the Roman army maintained discipline through the decimation. Defeats in battle were followed by decimation of legions. One in 10 drew lots, and that person was killed by their comrades. In the 1960s, we had the draft. Today, as captains of the charter schools, NFL draft, green cards continue to be lotteries. So in terms, lotteries are fair systems provided that they are random. So the current system is already a lottery, but does not have the advantage that it is random. And one of the major problems in implementing this is political. It is convincing administrators and political leaders to accept the data. Another problem is people's gut instinct that it's always against randomness. They think that there must be some good out of being ranked. But New Zealand has already moved to a modified lottery, and maybe this is something that could be done in the future. Another problem that has emerged in the last 5 years or so, beginning with this Wall Street Journal article, is how much science is reproducible. And this year, the problems came out of the biotech industry, who began to air their laundry in that they were licensing a lot of work that was subsequently not reproducible. So then this paper was published in 2012 from a company with Lee Ellis, arguing that many of the licensed studies for cancer research were not reproducible, and the poor quality of preclinical data, errors with cell lines, over-reliance on mouse models, and poor laboratory design. This was actually preceded by a print study that has shown that only about 11, it basically said 11% of the licensed work for another company had been reproducible. And if you work with scientists, you can get it up to about 33% or so. So I will return to that, but I want to point out that the media is, this is already out there. The problems of science are already being aired. This is cover of The Economist and two very interesting articles that I think every scientist should read. They are open access. So Farrakh and I wrote these articles. We thought that there had to be, science needed to be reformed. And we proposed back in 2012 reforms within science and outside of science. But go to scientists and tell them that there is a problem with science, and they'll look at you and they say the only problem is not enough money. And therefore, we needed to obtain evidence that there was, in fact, a problem. Where do you look at it? You look at the literature. This is the product of scientists. So if you find a problem in the literature, then you can maybe make a compelling case to scientists. So we began to look at retractions. So retractions have been rising disproportionately in the literature faster than the entries into PubMed. This is something we published recently. And this is the curve. The reason the blue curve goes down is because the papers in 2013 had not been retracted relative if you plot it by year. But if this continues unabated, the entire literature will be retracted in a few years. This is the consequences of retraction. This is an analysis that was published in Nature not in Nature, of a Nature paper. And you can see how this is a citation network. So all these studies refer to that article that was subsequently retracted. Retractions are a serious business in science. However, we should celebrate honest retractions. Those are when there are methodological errors, statistical errors, logical, and irreproducibility. Scientists who retract papers for good reasons should be complimented. They maintain the integrity of the literature. They should not be punished. We all make mistakes. However, retractions can also be dishonest, falsification, modification of data, fabrication, and straightforward conduct. So we carried out the first analysis of error in the literature, and what we found is, I think what most scientists would agree, that if you look at it, many of them are just the result of irreproducibility, laboratory errors that tend to be unique, although you can find systematic ways to reduce error, for example, problems related to programs, homegrown programs, problems of contamination, in error. And then we looked is there a relationship between the journal type and the retraction rate? And this is one of the most famous pieces of data. And you can see that there is a correlation between impact factor and the retraction index. We created the retraction index for journals such that these single word journals had a very high retraction rate. Science republished it and asked, why is this? Well, it could encourage risk-taking behavior by authors, everyday science often a messy affair, and Barbara Bradford suggested that the extra attention high-impact journals get might be the reason for the higher rate of retractions. Papers making the most dramatic advances would be the subject of the most scrutiny. So Farrakh and I said, fine, if that is the case, we're scientists, you can test it. We have the data. We know when the papers were published, and we know when they are retracted. So papers with the higher impact factor should be retracted faster than papers in the lower impact factors. So that was not the case. There had to be another explanation. And the other explanation, sadly, was that about 70% of the papers that were being retracted was because of misconduct. This was a shock at the time, and in fact, this paper may, in fact, end up being our most cited paper. I went to the chairs at Einstein when I had the data. I knew the paper was coming out. There were 33 chairs, clinical science and basic science, and I asked them what was the cause of retraction. And I remember that universally they said most of it is due to error. So around the same time, people have been carrying out questions. For example, questionable research practices. Fanelli has been a leader in this area and carried out the first study in which he went around and just asked people, hey, do you know people who committed questionable research practices? Have you done it yourself? And remarkably, some people actually admitted to having done it themselves. And this was another study that basically confirmed the same result. And I asked those of you who are involved in science, I'm sure that in your mind, you know of cases of questionable research practices. So I'm gonna tell you about the big study. This is something that was published this year. This is Elizabeth Bick. She worked in David Roman's lab, and she has an unusual hobby. She likes to look at journals for problems in her spare time. So she contacted Ferrick and I about 3 years ago, and she said, I'm finding a lot of problems. But what she was upset was not the problems, the fact that the journals were not responding to her. She would send the findings in, and they would blow her off. So I said, let's do this systematically. Let's get the data. So she analyzed 27,000 papers, 20,000 papers from 39 journals, 13 publishers, over 15 years by visual, focusing on photographic images. And then these things were sent to Ferrick and I, and we validated them, and we have a 90% concordance rate. So I will show you some of the data. Is there a problem with that figure? I mean, some of you have seen this, so you can't say anything, but I'm not going to torture you. I'm going to show you these two panels are the same, and you could say, well, maybe that's error. No, that cannot be error because the other panels are not the same, and in a facts plot, you cannot have a situation where some quadrants are the same and others are not. Is there a problem with that figure? This one, it may be a simple duplication in which you can see maybe they imported the wrong file. Is there a problem with this figure? This figure can drive you to drink. But I will show you many, many problems. First, here are two independent experiments. The bands are identical. Here they took a set of bands and they rotated them 180 degrees. Here they took the actin control and they rotated it 180 degrees. That was not the result of taking a JPEG, importing the wrong file. Is there a problem with this figure? It's the same panel. This is easy. Is there a problem with this figure? Well, you can see that they probably, in this case, it's probably error. They just imported the right ones, but you can see whether it's sloppiness or they just put the same ones in still. Is there a problem with this figure? Well, these two bands are identical. Is there a problem with this figure? I think by now you've gotten good at it. See, people already can see it. You can train people to do this, and this is one of the things that we hope to do. But it shows evidence of intent because they flipped it. They took the mirror image. And here is something that was published in the editor in the journal that I'm editor-in-chief. I don't mind showing you my dirty laundry. Same panel. They took the same panel. Same figure. They used it in two panels. And I think it's one more. No. Anyway, so the big study. So the prevalence of this is in 1 in 25 papers. 1 in 25 papers has something that Elizabeth Bick could identify by looking at visual inspection. That's not looking at histograms or any numerical data. The findings are an underestimate of the problems in the literature. The journals differ in prevalence, but the problem is a 21st century phenomenon. She found no cases in 1996, and then they take off. And right here, Photoshop, the suite was introduced. The artistic license, I forgot, Ferrick looked it up, but this was the time in which Photoshop became widely available. It used to be the way you made a figure, since you took your data to an artist, they photographed them. Now people prepare their own figures. Incidentally, if you want to do something about this in your own laboratory, all you need to do is to ask other people to prepare the figures, and the problem will probably go away. So some notable cases of misconduct in the last few years. I don't think some of these people need no introduction. Andrew Wakefield with the measles, Joaquin Bolt, over 150 retractions, basically just made up the data. And then the data was used to generate guidelines that have now been found to harm patients. This was in Forbes. This was featured in the New York Times. And this was the scandal at Duke that led to the, in their cancer center, where an ill party made data that influenced the treatment of patients. Now, you may notice something in that almost all these people are male, and we in fact found that males are greatly overrepresented among those committing scientific misconduct. Generally, when I'm here and I look at the audience, I see some of the ladies smiling, and I will tell you that, yes, you should smile, but there is a caveat in the data. We did not find the women. So it is totally possible that they committed at the same rate, they just don't get caught. So that's another study. We haven't figured out how to deal with that. But here is something else. We focus our ethics training on students. But everyone is susceptible to this, including very, very senior faculty. And one idea, although I don't want to suggest one more thing to add to people's busy curriculum, is that the need for maintaining this kind of training across all stages of one's career. We were the first to document the personal cost of misconduct. This was done by a student at the University of Pennsylvania. Basically, we work with whoever works with us. And there was a student at the University of Pennsylvania who says, I'm really interested in this, and I want to document it. So using the ORI files and all the grants that are funded, we in fact found that in terms of money that is spent, it's not that much. The great consequences are to the individual. People who commit misconducts tend to disappear from the literature, and they disappear from grant funding. So something that one should never do. What are the incentives for research misconduct? Monetary rewards. In some countries, you get additional money if you publish in certain journals. As research funding drops, people become desperate, and some may be tempted. Career advancement, they're basically publishing in some of the most prestigious journals. It's in some cases required for a job, and I would argue the scientific economic system itself. So the economic system of science is winner take all, and prestige is your currency. You basically do work, and then your peers give you the prestige. Prestige is related to credit, and this translates into prizes, grants, publication venue, et cetera. This is the fundamental economy by which people work in the laboratory. We have argued in this paper in Scientific American that there has to be better ways to organize the economic system of science. Winner-take-all systems have benefits, strong motivation. Society benefits by the rapid sharing of information. As soon as you make a discovery, you want to get it out because you want to get the credit. But they also encourage risk-taking. They provide disproportionate rewards to winners. You have three labs competing for something. One lab beats the other ones by 6 months. Why do you give all the credit to that lab? I mean, is that the single best way to apportion credit? They can create losses, they can encourage teaching, and I would argue that the most important is that competition can inhibit innovation. They also can cause problems for society. Here you have a story written in Nature about two groups that will not share data because they want to each publish first, dealing with an organism that can cause a pandemic. This is a paper that we did some years ago. It's the Nobel Prize Good for Science. So we analyzed as many Nobel Prizes as we could, and you can see that in almost all of them, there's a controversy. Not in yours, Peter. There was no controversy in your year. I went and checked before I had this slide in here. No, yeah, it was afterwards, the Hungarian guy, but there was no controversy So the question is, I mean, you sit back in the cool of the evening, is the Nobel Prize good for science? Well, it's got great benefits. It highlights science. In October, the world focuses on science. That is good. It celebrates accomplishment. It does, you do pay a price for it. It distorts history. Whenever a Nobel Prize is given, the history of the field is no longer the same. It's now associated with those who won. It could create unhealthy competition. And there are many documented happenings of that, and some fields may get stunned after you give the prize. But this is the epitome of the winner-take-all strategy, that ultimately you associate the discovery with some individuals and you give the prize. But I would point out that competition in science has to be looked at very carefully, because when you look at transformative discovery, it almost always occurs in the absence of competition. If you take scientists and you say, here is a goal, go for it, compete, what they try to do is they try to get to the end using existing tools. So competition in science stifles innovation. In fact, all these great discoveries occurred in the absence of competition. Once a discovery is made, a field established, and then people set goals, and then you have the competition emerge. And I will give you an example. DNA as a transforming principle, there was no field. In 44, this paper is published. Then there is the race to the structure, and all you have to do is read the double helix to see how ugly things can get. And I would point out that the solution to the problem was with existing tools. That is fiber diffraction. And obviously, Rosalind Franklin had the best data out there, And that's why these individuals were able to get the prize. I mean, Watson and Crick, and Linus Pauling didn't get it because his X-ray data was not as good. So I'm going to give you one example in my lab of how I like to do things. So there's only three data slides, but you know, we work on Cryptococcus neoformans, and this fungus has a capsule, and this capsule can get large depending on whether you put it in a mouse or you trigger an amoeba. So problem in the field determines, problem is capsule enlargement. These things can get very large. In fact, if you can color this, you could see it with an unaided eye. This is about 50 microns in size. So the mechanism of how this, without getting into it, is the organism continues to replicate without fission. And so it gets N to N, 4N, they get huge. It solves the problem of diffusion by making a huge vacuole, such that the whole cytoplasm is in the outside. And we were working on this, and we didn't think we had any competition. So I went to a Gordon conference, and I was in the back of the room. And then a young assistant professor got up and presented the same data that we had. How do you think I dealt with it? I give you some choices. One choice would have been that I called the postdoc and told them, your career is over. You're never going to get a job. You're about to get scooped. That's one choice. Choice number two is I would have kept my mouth shut, went home, and tried just to beat this other group. And choice number three is to approach this person and say, there has to be a better solution to me scooping you or you scooping me. And actually, we went for the third, and it worked out really nice. We both published at the same time. Both first authors got jobs. And everyone in here became much more interconnected as a result of cooperation. And the field benefit, the same story from two different labs. And I will tell you that there is more to this. We submitted it to a one-word journal. You know those one-word journals? And we send it to the one-word journal, and we ask the editor, please send it to the same reviewers, because we know that it's the same data. But the editor decided to send it to two different types of reviewers. And we know that reviews are very consistent. And that's why when you send the same paper to different journals, you always get the same outcome. Being sarcastic here. So our paper got trash. Their paper got essentially accepted. And the editor tried to work out a deal with them to ditch us. Because after all, it's a story, two papers. And because trust had been established, she didn't do it. And the person that I was dealing with was Kirsten Nielsen, who was at the time an assistant professor. I have done the same thing four different times with other labs, and I will urge you to think about it, that if you're in that situation, that there are better solutions than to beat other people. Because if you beat other people, you create losers. And it's, in fact, it's a lot more fun to do it this way, to share the credit. I want to talk about the impact factor distortion. And here is the error that publication venue equals publication quality. So the impact factor distortion is a new phenomenon, relatively new. When I trained, I had never heard about this. I heard it in the 90s. And it is based on the false promise that exclusivity equals quality. The top journals create an artificial scarcity. No matter how many papers you send to Nature, they publish the same. They provide disproportionate reward to winners. Yet when you break in, you get tremendous benefits because you get more people applying to your lab, you're much more likely to get the grants. But there has to be a cost. One is delays publication. It causes perverse incentives for scientists. They cascade their papers through journals. They try to get them in by often cleaning them up too much. Perverse incentives for journals, and it may promote this conduct. But the biggest scandal is that a paper published in one of these journals is not cited more than in the next tier. And this has been shown by multiple studies. They benefit disproportionately from the fact that the news and their review articles get cited. So one cannot even conclude that the citations are, in fact, higher if one gets them into those papers. This is a study that was done by Radames and Carlos and others in our group, and the literature has changed tremendously. So what do scientists do in response to this economy? They pack more stuff into their papers. The total number of data items goes up, the figure density goes up, the author number goes up. The only thing that goes down are references. Why? Why there is no incentive on citing things, because it hurts your novelty. So the impact factor is an example distortion and a tragedy of the commons in science. This is an economic theory by which people acting in their own interests damage the enterprise. And it's driven by individual scientists. This is not being driven by administrators or by grants. Scientists are bought into this, and you play the game, and once you break in, the rewards are basically help you, but you force everybody to play. But the problem is not everybody can win. So you create losers at a time in which science needs to be focused on getting good work and not getting into where it gets published. Here is a bigger problem. Impact is not importance. Here is an example of high importance and high impact. This, you could argue, ushered a revolution. Here you have high importance, no impact whatsoever. Mendel. If you remove Mendel from history, you go back into the 1870s and you shoot him at the monastery, the development of genetics is the same. It has no effect on it. Mendel gets rediscovery when there is a quarrel about priority between two different people that have reproduced his results. You could have high impact and no importance. The arsenic paper is still in science, has not been retracted, arguing that you could have life based on arsenic, or you could have low impact or low importance, and that's a lot of the literature that is never cited. So why is this important? Because if we reward, if impact is not importance and we reward impact, then the course of science may be skewed such that the most important work is not done. This is a real problem, and this is one of the costs of the mania, and this is why the dean and the other chairs know I strongly rebel against people basically using it for promotion or using numerology in assessing scientists. So in the summer of 2015, published what is probably my most controversial paper, and it had a very simple message. We're spending more to stay in place while knowing much more. And the paper looked at a variety of indicators and suggested that despite what we know, we're making a lot less progress than what we should. Here's an example. I made a list of discoveries in medicine from 1950 to 1980, from 1980 to 2010. All these things have gotten better, but all these revolutionary things began at a time with the amount of, when what was known was a lot less than it is today. So innovation in medicine, despite great know, at least the translation to what matters, that is my mother's medicines, is not getting there. So what's going on? Well, I don't know. I'm the first one to say I don't know. It could be increased regulation. It could be less efficient drug discovery. Development takes too long. Maybe it was low-hanging fruit, although it is very hard for me to believe that the discovery of beta blockers was low-hanging fruit based, if you go back and you read the papers, at a time in which nobody knew anything about receptors. You could have mergers. Companies don't innovate. They basically buy other companies. You have a culture of short-term rewards. Or you could have problems with science, which are contributing, as I began pointing it out, or you could have all of the above. So I'm a physician, and I like to give patients a single diagnosis. And I would say that when my one-line diagnosis that the norms of science are out of sync with the reward system of science. What are the norms of science? Rigor, reproducibility, responsibility, doing good work. What do we reward? Impact, flashiness, where you publish, what your H index is. This is a dissonance. And this is at the heart of the problem. But I want to end with optimism. And I want to point out that despite all this and all this bad news, science is not broken. When I was a house officer in Bellevue Hospital in 1985, if you had HIV, AIDS, you died. I mean, it was a matter of months. Today, individuals with HIV infection can live normal lives. And that did not happen because we basically improved the care of 1985. That we basically develop drugs that change the complete outcome of the disease. The same may be beginning to happen with cancer. CRISPR-Cas9 will be a revolution, unquestionably. Curiosity and the other rovers continue to tell us about Mars. We visited Pluto. The Higgs boson was found 4 years ago, 5 years ago now, and this is a great moment in humanity. The most complicated machine ever made produces a piece of data that allows the completion of the standard model. At least one part of physics is all holding together. Your cell phone has at least 3 Nobel Prizes in it. And vaccines are coming for preventing cancer. But perhaps one of the happiest days of my life was this year, February a year ago, with the detection of gravitational waves and the implication of what this means for us as a species. Think about it this way. Two black holes, one about 14 sizes, mass of the size of the sun, and the other one about 17,000, spin into each other a billion years ago at a time when life in Earth is unicellular. These gravitational waves travel through space and time for a billion years. During that time, life in Earth organizes itself to build an interferometer to listen to it. The universe is aware of itself through us and through our science. And this is one of those things that, when I think about it, gives me chills and goosebumps. This is what we can do as a species. It's really, really remarkable, and it's something to be celebrated, and the science is a very human enterprise. The government has gotten in, so we have reproducibility initiatives, and they are beginning to produce data. The reproducibility project, this was just published last month, the first studies are in. Remember, some company raised questions with cancer studies, so they went to try to reproduce them. Two out of the five were reproduced, one out of five was definitely not reproduced, and two out of five was inconclusive because the variables had changed such that they couldn't conclude anything or the other. So the major insight is the question of what is reproducible and needs to be studied. This work was just published in eLife, and perhaps it's the beginning of a new field. We need to understand, in fact, what reproducibility means to try to improve it. Harold Barmas has given us an alternative CV. The reason when you put in a grant, you now have to put in a new CV every time, is to minimize the impact of publications. You get a chance to tell them what you did. It's a pain, but it's a lot better than what people were doing was listing their 15 high-impact publications. Randy has been arguing for a boycott. I don't agree with boycotts. I agree with changing systems. Not necessarily this, but at least here you have a well-known individual asking for change. The DOOR initiative came out about 4 years ago, arguing that the numerology should not be used in judging scientists. I have signed on to it. I don't know if our school has signed on to it, but I think it's very important to maintain this. We have tried humor. Now, humor can be very dangerous, especially with scientists. But for example, CNS depression, the feeling in your paper has been rejected by Cell Nature and Science. The malady abates when the paper, you could have the borderline probability disorder. These are the people who swear by 0.05 but deny 0.06. You could have nobelitis, a rare but debilitating condition that affects only the scientific elite. Might be manifested by auditory hallucinations involving telephone callers with Swedish accents. Seasonal incidence is frequently observed with rising anticipation in fall, followed by prolonged depression once the prize awarded and the afflicted individual has not been selected. Or you could have my favorable, gelatophobia, the fear of being scooped. So there are 33 diseases of scientists that we came up with. This was the most fun I ever had writing a paper. Ferrick and I kept sending them. This is being incorporated into ethics courses. Maybe it'll make a difference. The ASM has come up with a poster that you can download if you want it. When I travel, I see the poster in some places, a lab door at the University of Arkansas. And here is Rich Lenski, a well-known geneticist. There is the Mona Lisa, and look what's next to it. The poster is right there. So I think that, you know, if you can make it a different person at a time, that's worthwhile. Societies are beginning to get their act together. The ASM, for example, has eliminated impact factor information from the journal websites, and this week, FEMS is debating the same proposal, and the idea is to try, look, you can always find it. All you have to do is Google it, but we're not gonna give it to you. And certainly, if you're gonna make a decision based on that, we may not want your paper. So we have suggested various things for reforming science, for over-specialization, put the PhD back in the PhD. I'll say a few more words about that. Scientists need to have a lot more quantitative training, increase in all aspects. For impact factor mania, we need to focus on findings, not papers. For irreproducibility, enhanced rigors, checklist. The winner-take-all strategy, we need to find new ways to give credit. For misconduct, enhanced focus in ethics. Software advances, databases. This is kind of dated now. So it's 5 years ago, but at least we're thinking on how we may bring this about. So one of the things I want to point out is that previous scientific giants had a much broader education than we do today. Today, for example, the way we train scientists, there are some great things about what we do. Anybody who gets a PhD in the biomedical sciences comes out with the capacity to do deep work. The problem is that that's all we teach them. And we think that it's possible to keep what is good while at the same time give the tools for critical thinking and give the tools for greater breadth. And the expression that we use is putting the PhD back into PhD, since it is, after all, a doctor of philosophy. So here, and this is, many deserve credit, and nonetheless, than Mike Clagg, who supported this. And without Mike, I can assure you, there would be no program. Gundula has been taking the lead. She launched the first course, and the idea is to develop an innovative track that maintains what is good, while at the same time taking our students and giving them critical thinking tools that can be used anywhere. For example, a paper appeared yesterday in the bioarchives taking apart the logic, to showing how illogical it is to rely on impact factor. And it goes through all the logical arguments, and it basically shows, and not only will I believe that this will lead to better science, but it may also lead to better citizens as you, in terms of analyzing data. So checklists have been introduced in society. The next time you go into an airplane, look to your left, they're doing a checklist. Airplane technology has not changed significantly in the last 40 years. Airplanes are safer now than ever are. Why? Because you put in place systems that reduce error. So that's and the same thing is happening in the operating room, in medications, and science. Nature introduced a checklist a couple of years after we suggested it, and I think this is one way in which you can look at your operation, introduce some checklists, error can be reduced in the laboratory. What can you do? Well, the first thing is to be optimistic. Science is really a young endeavor. It's been around for 250 years or so. Support science. Focus on the three R's: rigor, reproducibility, and responsibility. Ask questions. Somebody, next time you hear somebody said to you, the paper was published in filling the single, ask him, why are you using the journal's name? Is it because you're warning me that it may be retracted? Just a simple question like that will have an effect as it permeates through the system. Ask him what was in the paper. You know, you'd be amazed how few people can tell you. Get involved. And I can tell you that individuals can make a difference. I can tell you that Ferrick and I have done this. We don't get grant funding for this. This is not all, we've done this on the side. And yet that it is possible to do that. And one of the things I will tell you, one of the things that I'm most proud of that I was involved in in the last few years, was that I was in charge of the ASM general meeting. And I had available to me the data on all the prior meetings. And I noticed that no matter how many women were attending the meeting, the percentage, you can go back, was fixed around 30%. So we began to look at their differences between sessions and noted that if you have a female convener put together a session, that the female participation on average goes up by 70%, and the likelihood of an all-male session reduces comparably. So I approached Joe Handelsman because I thought that this was an interesting observation. So we published this paper, I think it was in 2012, 2013, and then we took the data and we brought it to the general meeting. And the intervention was just showing the people in the committee the data. And that resulted in a significant jump. And then in the following year, we were able to achieve gender equity speakers by 2015. So this is getting away from conscious, unconscious biases. It's possible to do these things in a very rapid time. So what I'm interested in is finding systems that are not dependent on personality. So just asking that every session be convened by a male and a female, at least makes it, takes care of the problem, because it makes sense. Women have more women in their network. And you're gonna ask people in your network to invite. So problems like this, I believe, can be resolved relatively easily. So the situation today, much greater awareness of the problem in the general media. Many scientists are increasingly concerned. You're beginning to see small steps towards reform, checklist, door, new format. The scientific leadership, that is the honorific, has finally begun to react to this enormous threat to science. And the U.S. government has launched several initiatives. For example, here's American Society of Cell Biology, an initial looking at the problem of reproducibility. So I will tell you that when I got into this, I would say around 2006, 2007, people who care about me scientifically told me, don't do it. Don't do it. Don't get yourself involved in this. Get your workout. And I said, look, I'm going to get my workout. They said, you know, there are going to be repercussions. And I'm happy to tell you that there have been no repercussions. In fact, you guys hired me after I was in the middle of all of this. Think about that. We had our 15 minutes of fame. We got featured in the New York Times a couple of years ago. And the other 15 minutes of fame, we got featured in Science and trying to improve the system. And I want to end by acknowledging Ferrick Fang, who's been my collaborator through all of this, Joan Bennett, Grant Steen, Elizabeth Big, Joe Handelsman, Tony Bowen, Radames. I should have added Carlos to this too, and the American Society of Microbiology, which has allowed me to use a lot of their data. Thank you very much.
So I'm not quite as pessimistic as you are because I'm not a journal editor, I think. It seems to me when I've been involved in investigating issues with illustrations, people always blame Adobe Illustrator, that it's just too complex. But I think the errors that I've seen in my career made by others are because they feel constrained by resources. So, for example, in epidemiologic studies, the kinds of errors we've detected have been where data entry errors because there's not good quality control measures, and then in people who don't understand statistical analysis. And so most of the things I've encountered have been true mistakes. But epidemiologists, by and large, don't get rich. And part of what's driving this is tech transfer, I think, and the idea of selling IP and scoring big. And there's tremendous pressure in universities now to do tech transfer, because you showed the funding from NIH. And so do you think, I guess the question is, do you think that the push to do tech transfer plays any role in the rise in retractions?
It's funny you say that because that's something that we're working on. I believe that the Dole-Bay Act of 1980, that's why they cut off in 1980. I believe the focus away from basic science that happened at universities is contributing, in fact, to a lot of this. I think that it introduced a new reward system into the university system that is not what they do best. Mm-hmm. And I realize that we're not going to turn the clock back, but that separation that existed between what was academic and what was industrial basically blurred. Mm-hmm. And I think, like everything involving humans, you had positives and you had negatives, mm-hmm. but the negatives are not being discussed mm-hmm. sufficiently.
Mm-hmm. Great. So maybe I can ask Ellen to see whether this is correct or not, but you pointed out checklists and pilots. Wasn't that based on Sue Baker's work, checklists and aviation?
She did some very early work on that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I've always seen her credited for developing that model of checklists. She's on our faculty in health policy and management. So it's a quiet audience, right? Yeah. So you have to use the microphone because it's being recorded, and the people who are listening won't hear the question, okay?
Hi, I'm Kiara Ashton, I'm a graduate student. Have you done anything in your department to get away from the Cell Science Nature publishing when you do hire assistant faculty for new?
Well, I mean,
positions.
There are people here on the search committee, and one of the things that I instructed them was that they tell me what they did, not where they published. I mean, we can do it at that level. I mean, I can tell you that people are still drawn to those things. And changing a culture is the hardest thing when it comes to humans. But so we have created this culture, which is unscientific, in so many ways irrational, and yet we are all bought into it because it serves the system. And taking this apart is going to take a while.
And what do you tell to your students if they have the option to?
I tell them that like everything in life, you often have to deal with inconsistencies, that the world will judge you by the situation. So try to publish in an area, in a journal that people are aware of, the more general it is, but never for a second judge the value of work based on its venue.
Hi, Arturo. Hi. One of the issues to deal with misconduct across the street in the School of Medicine is to provide storage for your data, the data that's linked to that publication and those figures in a non-adjustable format, and that the school could provide that. At an institutional level, you can make it clear that there'll be a way to track back. Many instances of misconduct, you can't actually go back to find where is the original lab notebook and where are these pictures and where are the data. Do you think the recognition that there is this check on the findings, do you think that would solve some of the issues, or do you think people will find a way around it?
Well, I think people who want to do misconduct always find a way around anything. I mean, when you raise the bar, but I do think that there are a lot better ways to archiving data and to do so, and I think that some of those are going to be forced upon us by the funding agencies. You know, the old notebook that you can rip the pages out isn't going to do it anymore.
As a journal editor, do you think it's the role of the journals to archive the data?
No. No. Journals are, just so you think about it, journals are generally tend to be non-profit organizations with very small margins, and they're already overwhelmed with appendices.
Sort of switching gears, unless someone else has a question. So there's these data that talk about increasing rewards to individual investigators. You get one NIH grant, it makes you more likely to get the next one. The rich get richer, which many of us here at Hopkins have benefited from that paradigm.
So have I.
And we call it a meritocracy.
Right, so
do you agree with some of the initiatives like NIGMS and the fund the person rather than the project, extend the duration while reducing the amount?
So I don't agree with, I guess it's my own background. I don't agree with any with clear limits, but I do agree with greater inspection. That is that if you have a very productive lab that requires the funds and they have a very large budget, give it to them, but inspect it. But as people begin to get more and more money, one should be looking at what is the cost per publication. So there's only been one study done, and it was done by a person at the NIH that found that if you have no money, you produce nothing. And the thing is, you add money, it peaks at $700,000 per lab. And then the amount of money per paper becomes more inefficient. So that's the kind of study that one should be doing. You could do it to a specific labs, and you could do it based on different types of science. So I guess what I'm saying is I don't believe in blanket rules that affect everybody. I believe in nuance, taking these things into account.
So that's numerology, though. You said don't do numerology. That's numerology, counting publications.
So numerology, I object primarily how it applies to scientists. Mm-hmm. I think that when you can still look at the output of a lab and you can see how much the lab has, and you can do a rough calculation on it. But I do think that some quantitative measures can be used at the level of laboratory, but I would not use them at the level of scientist.
Hi, so I'm a graduate student here. My name's Emily. I've never heard of labs collaborating instead of scooping each other before, and I was wondering if you could speak more to that and how to facilitate those types of interactions.
So first of all, so I'm glad you asked me that question, and if you get something out of one person changes, this was a successful lecture, right? So the way it does is you talk to the other lab. The way it happened here is she was as upset as we were. She was actually far more upset because she was an assistant professor. I was already established investigator. If I get scooped, you know, so what? But so what you do is you approach the other person and you say, look, let's try to publish at the same time. And it's amazing how nicely it can work. We waited for one another. There were some things that we did better than they did. There were other things. So the papers are not identical, but the main finding is complementary. And I can tell you that I've done it all, and you end up with very nice relationships with other labs. These people are your friends forever. You establish trust. So try it.
So good. Well, if there are no other questions, you know, it was a great talk. You're always so thought-provoking. And I think it's really hard to see the water that you swim in. You know, like when you grow up in a system and you have inputs, outputs, you know, these reinforcing agents, we don't see them. So your ability to step back with Ferrick and look at the water we swim in is really important work. So.
Oh, thank you.
And I've just got a text that the food may be a little bit late from the daily run, but please, I think there's wine out there, so we can step out and have a drink.
Thank you.
Please thank our tour.